here with us tonight, who is a very talented flute player. He is an expert not only in Native American flutes, but also in Norwegian and Middle Eastern flutes. He has performed with the Dalai Lama, and we are so, so excited to hear him perform tonight. Give him a big round of applause.
Wow, April, I don't like to top that. That's pretty good, pretty good. Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you, Las Lake Oswego Library and Friends of the Library and the folks that came tonight and stuff. So I'll be doing a bit of storytelling and that kind of go with the flutes. It's not really like so much tribal storytelling because I didn't grow up on a tribe or a reservation. And I explain who I am and where I come from in that story, because I have parents from two different places completely. I do have indigenous ancestry, and I'll explain that to you as well. Actually, I have it on both sides. My father, because you already heard my last name, it's Ali. And I'm sure you're curious, is how does somebody with the last name Ali do this? Very simple. And so it was. This has been my healing, and this has been my medicine. So I'm gonna put this thing down here, but. I picked this instrument up 20 years ago. I think I say that every year. And it was a way to heal. Are there any small children in the audience here? No, I don't see one, okay. I'll be cautious. I was going through a bad divorce. And those are usually not a lot of fun. And it was, in my case, traumatic. And so it was my second divorce. And I won't go into too much detail, but I was having a really tough time on it. So I know that sometimes when people go through a tough time, they self-destruct, and they maybe drink themselves away or drugs or whatever. But fortunately, my parents taught me some common sense. I didn't really want to do that. I was the only one living in Washington State. By the way, I live in Bellingham, Washington. And so it was. We left at 10:30, and we got down here an hour or so ago. And so so we did, I think we did pretty good. So, but anyways, so I got, I'll tell that story. I'll tell how it started. But I want to start with a song. And what I'm going to be doing is I have this so I can pretend I'm playing in a canyon. I have a little knobs on here and that make that sound. You know, I'm sure you all may have heard of our Carlos Nakai. Carlos Nakai, I've met him before and I talked to him. He was kind of my inspiration as well as some other people. So what I'll do is I'll talk like I am now, then I'll turn the canyon on. When I'm done playing a song, I'll turn the canyon off. And then, now I have a foot pedal that'll help me do that, but I'm not that techie. I'm like, I haven't figured out how to hook it up, so. So, I play from the heart. That means I don't read music at all. I taught myself how to play. And so, if you are a musician and you go, oh yeah, five-note pentatonic scale. I don't know what that means. I don't really care and stuff. The tradition of the instruments was to play from the heart anyways. Thank you. I just made that up. And so that's playing from your heart. This first flute I've played is a Lakota style flute. It's one of my favorite flutes. It's in the key of A. And I had it autographed by somebody I played music for. That's Buffy St. Marie. You all know Buffy St. Marie? I've met her three different times. And I was one of many musicians I got to open for at the Stillaguamish Festival of the River that used to take place every year in Arlington, Washington. Also, I had, unfortunately, his name has faded away because the Sharpie doesn't work very well, with John Trudell. And I met John Trudell because I used to teach part-time at Northwest Indian College at the Lummi Reservation and the Tulalip Reservation. So anyways, I'm going to retire this flute soon because I don't want to lose the autographs that are on here. I have John Tuhawk, he's a Lakota flute player, and Mary Redbone. And she is also a native performer, and her son, Zach, signed it when he was 4. That was years ago. So when I started doing this, like I said, 20 years ago, I went to, we were separated, and I was living in an apartment in Paulsbo, Washington. And I decided to walk out down into town, and there was an art festival going on. I thought it was, really cool, and it was down by the waterfront, and I could hear native flute playing, and I've always liked native flute music. I never, ever thought that I would be playing this instrument. So I went up to a table, and it was kind of like a table with flutes on it, and there was a couple of smiley guys, going, hey, we're making sell flutes. You can try one of these. And I go, oh, no, I don't know how to play any instruments, but I'll listen to the man who's playing your flutes. And that man was Charles Littleleaf from the Warm Springs Reservation, and it's from here in Oregon, and his fiery Italian wife, Vicky. And really nice people. I listened to the music. It pulled my heart, and I was thinking, oh, I wish my wife was here. She could hear this. Maybe we could kind of work things out and stuff. But I came back the next day and listened to some more of it. Anyways, what happened was he gave me a CD, and I talked to him for a little bit. I decided, I'm going to get me one of those flutes, I think. And I saved up a little money, and a month later, I drove to the home of the flute maker. The flute maker, Stellar Flutes, is who made these flutes that you see on this table here. And they're in Shelton, Washington. And Tom Stewart was there with his son, Matt. Matt doesn't do flutes anymore, but it's just him and his daughter and some other folks now. But Tom's been making flutes for many years. He's not native. He is Scottish, and I'm not sure what else he is, but he's a really good man. He's got a good heart, and it's in the right place. So I went up to his home and his shop, and he put some flutes out. And he put this one out. And that was the one I picked. Or as we say, this is the one that picked me. Now, it didn't have the glass beadwork on it. This was done later. But this guy, the finish is worn off on it. It's in F sharp. I didn't know what I was doing. I just said, this is the one. And I got a little booklet. And away you go. And so I would go to the park, and I would figure this thing out where my fingers needed to go. And I would take the ferry boat, the Washington State Ferries, from Kingston over to Edmonds. I would go up in the solarium because it echoed. It was kind of cool. And I would kind of play. But I would not play in public. No way. And that wasn't until later, until I got brave enough, because I was kind of extroverted, I think is the word. But this got me out of my shell. But this also got me out of a lot of things, healing-wise. I did finally get through the divorce, and it took forever, and it still kind of bit me after that, just what I went through and stuff. But there's some other challenges that came through my life that this helped me get through, including cancer. So the next flute I'm going to play is a woodland-style flute. This is kind of a little bit different than the Lakota, the flutes from the Midwest. This flute was given to me by my friend Lowell Newland. And Lowell Newland was Cherokee and Choctaw. And the woodland people are those who call themselves the Toslagi, the which is Cherokee, and the Iroquois, and the Choctaw. And so the flutes are a little brighter, so I'll play you a song from this. The thing I always say to my audience about Lowell was also a Vietnam veteran. And during the dark, dark days of Vietnam, he was a door gunner and a Huey. And that was his job. And when he came home, his elders taught him how to make flutes. And this was his medicine to help him get through the PTSD. I remember Vietnam really well, because I was still in high school when that was going on. I think Vietnam ended in, what, 75? I got out of high school in 76. I'll play you a song. So in this flute journey, you know, I asked my parents, I go, so what are we? You know, I was born in California, and that's where I was raised, in Southern California. And my parents would say, well, you're half Moroccan and half Mexican. And I'm like, those are places. Who are we as people? And they could not answer that question. So I, you know, as I got older, I had to do my own searching. My mom was orphaned as a little kid. My dad came over to the United States when he was 14. He lied about his age, and he came over on the Andrea Doria. Remember the Andrea Doria? Of course, she sunk in the early 50s when she was hit by the Stockholm and sunk in the Atlantic. My dad wasn't on that sailing. But thanks to my father's uncle, my granduncle, Uncle Ahmed. I remember Uncle Ahmed. He was a nice man. I liked him. And before my father passed, he had told me, and which was 3 years ago, he told me, yeah, your uncle, you know, he was a hitman. I'm like, what? Well, but the thing is, too, about it was he was also a veteran of the Spanish Civil War. And he left Morocco because of that, being a hitman kind of thing, and he ended up in New York. And while he was in New York, he would meet the woman that would be his wife. Now, I don't know if they got married in New York, but anyways, this woman was escaping from her country, and that's why she ended up in New York. She was with her sister and her sister's new husband and her dad. And here's the clue I usually give my audience, the younger people can usually don't, like, huh? And her sister's new husband was German Jew. So obviously it was kind of before World War II. So while they could get out of there, they got out of there. And her father was involved with Hitler's army and wanted no part of that. So they got out of there. So somewhere they got married, and they ended up in California with a chicken ranch. And then my dad came over, and he had to pay his uncle back. And so he worked on the chicken farm. And there was a Hispanic worker, and they could speak the same language, you know, because Morocco had been colonialized by Spain and France. And so they became friends, and he asked my father, hey, come over and visit my family. And my dad says, okay. So he went over to what I call over the, what did I call that? The imaginary border. That is correct. He went across the imaginary border into the little town of Tecate, Mexico. There's a beer named after it, I believe. And he met this family, and they had an adopted girl in this family. My dad, they didn't like each other at all. But after 2 years, here I am. So, oh yeah, I was getting back to the flute music, okay. So I'm gonna play a flute here that sounds, I did find out that my grandfather played, he was the flute player. But I didn't know this until he was long gone. And he played a flute called the Nai, or the Ney, an ancient flute. It's from Egypt, and it's they find these buried with the pharaohs, and sometimes they still play. Well, my grandfather played at weddings and ceremonies in much the same way that I do with these. And I wish I would have known that. I couldn't talk to him anyways. I did meet him at one point. I don't speak Arabic. I only know a couple words, but at any rate, I thought that was kind of cool. It's in my genes, I suppose. And so... so now, you know, my grandfather's an ancestor as well as my father. He is now an ancestor, as I will be someday. This sounds pretty close to what my grandfather would have played, except it doesn't have the octave range. I think that we all come from everywhere as far as our ancestry goes, and I do share some of that. Asking my dad. My dad's, oh, we're this and that and the other, you know. My dad, you know, is being like my father. I knew that we have, we're Berber. Our ancestors are the Berbers. And we got that name, I think, from the Greeks or the Romans. It means barbarian. We're not barbarians. But I also have, somewhere in there, I have Ashkenazi Jew, I have Moor, I have Iberian Peninsula, I have a great-grandfather five generations back from Siberia. And I also have a connection with the Sami. And they're from the Nordic countries. Let's see. Okay. Believe me, I was like totally excited when I found that out. And I went to Ballard. That is like Nordic country there, if you've ever been to Ballard. I went to one of the things over at the museum, and maybe it was Yulefest, I don't know, but I talked to an interesting man who knows the history of the Vikings. And I said I was Berber, and my dad said, oh, the Vikings used to trade with the Berbers. It was a known fact. Their trade routes are in the Mediterranean. Oh, yeah, they stopped in Morocco, and they traded. I'm like going, yes. And so my grandfather is very fair-skinned, very light hair, very light eyes when he was alive. So there may have been more than just trading stuff going on and all that. But I did find out when I read up on some technical stuff that there's a DNA match with the Berbers and the Sami, the reindeer people of the Nordic country, especially near Finland and stuff. So cool. Thank you very much for that. This is in the key of A, Arabic A. Well, the technical part of that is that they might say, well, it's A minor or something like that, and I go, I don't know what that means. Just the way the holes are cut and the bore of the instrument, I think is what gives it its tuning, and also that it's in, I think that this is in 440 megahertz, I guess, because now things are tuned into that way. I just don't know the technicalities of it. I kind of go by the ear and how it sounds. I actually have a flute coming from a guy from Egypt who's making me a flute. He lives in Toronto, and it's a double flute. I think it's in the key of A. It's an Arabic tuning. So I'm really, fortunately, I didn't get it for today, but it's apparently going to be coming soon. But this was given to me quite a few years ago. So that's my way of speaking to my ancestors with this here. So. So when I did the DNA thing and I got the thing back, I did 23andMe, by the way, years ago. It says, and I, you know, trying to tell my mom we have Native ancestry. It's kind of a no-brainer. Mexico are Indians. But, you know, colonialization just almost killed us, all of us, or at least my ancestors. And pretty much brainwashed them. But my mom refused to really talk about it because they were taught otherwise in school when she was a little kid. My mom's like 83 or something now. But she was told some not very nice things about Native people in Mexico that I'm not going to repeat. But I was like going, wow, cool, I knew we were Native. You know, so it's funny. I went to a powwow years ago in Muckleshoot. And I was standing by my car, and a couple of tribal members walked by, and they go, hey, where are you from? And I looked at them, and I'm like, Snohomish? And they weren't asking me what town I lived in. Oh, and I said, oh, my mom's from Mexico, blah, 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 blah. Oh, hey, you're one of us, man. Cool. Felt cool to be accepted. All right, let's see if I can get this guy playing. Like that. This is called a drone. It's two flutes in one. It looks like a double-barreled shotgun, which it's not. It's made out of cedar. This is modeled after Mayan flute, Mayan style flute. Okay, but the flute makers that make them call them drones. And I got this one from Stellar Flutes. So there's some makers that still make them out of clay. They're awful expensive though. This one is, I love the way it sounds. Cedar is a nice wood. It's the original wood for most native flutes, depending on where the tribe is. As you know, these instruments never reached here, right? You know, the Grand Ronde folks, they didn't have these here. Coast Salish people had drums, not flutes. And so I found that through the DNA thing that my ancestry is Mayo and Pima. I have tribal ancestry. My mother is from the state of Sonora, Mexico, near Hermosillo. And there's a lot of Yaqui people there, but there's also Pima, and not Pima from Arizona, Pima in Mexico, upper and lower Pima, and the Mayo, not Mayan, and stuff. So that's what I know. Most of her is also Southern European. And so she didn't keep track of when her ancestors came over from Europe to Mexico or how any of that happened. There are no pictures of her parents, my grandparents. I don't know what they look like. But she does have four or five other siblings that I've never met. I've seen pictures of them. And through the magic of Facebook, she reunited with them several years ago because a cousin reached out to me and says, "Tú eres el hijo de Juanita Puzani?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And that was in Spanish, "Are you the son of Juanita Puzani?" And I said that I am. And that was somebody in Arizona, a cousin, a Buzani. Now, Buzani sounds Italian, but believe me, it's probably more Portuguese than anything. Portugal, like I said, the Iberian Peninsula. And my mom is very fair, and she doesn't have black hair anymore, but at any rate, I got my cool tan from my Berber side. So anyways, this is a Mayan style flute. There you go. This is the newest flute I have. This is made by Douglas Thunderhorse, Oklahoma. And I got this in January after he posted it on Facebook in December. And so I said, you know, if that's available, I want it. And so I like the coastal artwork he's done on it. It's very beautiful. And I was looking to get some new instruments for this year anyways. And so it's in the key of G. Yeah, I think it's in the key of G. I think it's, I'm not quite sure. It might be walnut. I'm not sure about the wood, but sure, it's darn pretty though. But I'll play you a short little song from it. This is probably only the third time or whatever I've played this in public. These are all mine. Yeah, I had nobody teach me anything, so I taught myself. Anybody in this room can play. If you are breathing, you can play. Believe me, I didn't think I could play anything, and I got to be one of eight or nine individuals at the Key Arena in Seattle and play with the Dalai Lama on stage, and I thought that was the coolest thing ever. And I call my mom and I go, "Mom, I got to play for the Dalai Lama," and she goes, "Oh, that's nice." She doesn't know who that is, so. Thank you. So this little wood thing on the top of the instrument is called the block or the bird. But if I move it, there's two, you probably can't see in the back, there's two little holes. Okay, and there's a chamber in the back hole. So there's a wall between these two holes. So the piece of wood, it sits on top, is cut about the thickness of a credit card underneath it. So when it sits over it, it allows just enough air to escape from one hole and force it down to the other hole down the tube. And that's how simple they were. So they have to line, that block wood's got to line up just right on the edge of the second hole in order to work properly. And that's how they work. And some of them are more decorative and that's all that is. But they're hand tied on. They're never glued on. They're not tied in a knot or not tied in a bow. And let's say you get somebody to carve you something way cool. That way you can take it off and put something else on. But that's pretty much how they're made. There's a little bit more to it, but to answer your question, sir. So here's another Lakota style flute. This is, you can see it's a bird, a loon. And this is made like probably some flutes that look similar to this guy over here. I have some of his flutes, Guillermo Martinez. He is from California. I used to meet him every year before the pandemic at the Bellevue Festival of the Arts. And he sold his flutes there, but now he does strictly online. But we stay in touch. Anyways, this is the second copy of this flute that I have. I have one that looked just like it, and I'll tell you the story. Every year, pretty much, I go play at Northwest Folklife in Seattle, and that's Memorial Day weekend. Usually I spend 1 or 2 days there. I take all these flutes, this stuff, the table, the rack, except this, and that's a lot of stuff to haul around, and I always park on the third floor of the Mercer Street parking. So after my day of doing everything, I try to take everything off and put it in my car, get on the road, hit I-5 north, boom, to Bellingham. Well, guess what I left on the roof of the car? Yes, indeed. So I sent pictures of the one I had, and I sent to Guillermo, and I go, you need to make me another one. He goes, why? And I told him. So another thing happened was with this flute, I was playing, and I had some kids in the audience. And the kids, they looked at my flute, and they'll go, that's not a loon. It's an evil rabbit. What do you mean, evil rabbit? It's got the ears and the grin and the eyes. No. Lakota loon. No, evil rabbit. Okay, whatever, kid. It's my loon, so. This is in the key of F sharp, for those music purists. It's called the grandfather key. That's what I've been told. Because these used to be keyed to the maker's voice in the old days. These are all keyed in Western scale, because when the Europeans came here, they go, cool, we'll make these so that we can play with them with our instruments. And so that's kind of what happened. And also a lot of flute players have these, are all on different key, even Carlos Nakai. There's one guy who I met who's pretty famous. He was also a hoop dancer. He passed away not too long ago. Oh my goodness, I forgot his name. I should be taking more fish oil. But I know. It's like, anyhow, let me play you a song. Maybe I can remember his name. Thank you. When I talk about healing, the other part of my life where these really came in and helped was, and that, of course I mentioned that I got to play for the Dalai Lama. That was 2008, the Seeds of Compassion tour. Well, later that year, I went to the doctor, and because I had like a funny pain in my groin. And guys aren't really one to talk about stuff like that. So, gals are kind of all over the place about it. And that's good that you are. That's because it's informative. And so my girlfriend at the time, she's, yeah, go to the doctor. I'm like, and then I do, and he couldn't find nothing. He goes, go get an ultrasound. So got an ultrasound. Then I get a call the next day, you need to come in. And then I try to self-diagnose on the computer. Worst thing ever. So I went to go see a urologist. And he said, well, you know, he showed me on the screen on the computer, and I didn't know what he was looking at. So he said, let's take some blood. Okay. So 45 minutes later, he says, oh, you have cancer. And I'm like, oh, okay. And I was feeling pretty, lots of anxiety going on. Well, so here, you have some choices, he says. You can get a second opinion, or you can do nothing at all, or I have surgery open in 3 days. I said, I'll take the surgery. And so what it came out to be is that I had testicular cancer. And so when they went in there and did their thing, they found two kinds of cancer, and I lost the body part, thank goodness for us, I suppose, because he said, I was 50 or something at the time. He goes, are you done having kids? And I'm like, I'm pretty sure, you know. And so anyways, you know, did the surgery and everything, and then had to go see an oncologist, and I thought we were done with all this. Why do I have to go see an oncologist? So I remember him, Dr. Oliver Batson, Everett Clinic, and so went to the hospital or where his office was, and he said, well, the CT scan shows this. Your cancer has traveled to about 6 inches behind your belly button into your lymph nodes. Here's what we can do. You can we can do surgery and chemo, or you can get a second opinion or do nothing at all. So something to the effect. And I said, well, let's just do the chemo. He said, good choice. I said, you've already cut into me once. That's enough. And so I did that. I did from 2009 to the end of March 2009. And I was on the third floor at the hospital in Everett, and it was pretty boring. I had 5 hours a day with the chemo plugged into my arm. I didn't have a port. I said, no, I don't want a port. I said, but the nurse had to find a vein like every day, and sometimes she didn't hit it. So it got kind of painful, but you know, I went through it, and like a trooper, I suppose, and I asked them if I could bring my couple of flutes into play, and they said, sure. So we have the third floor of people that are in the infusion center, and I'm playing a couple songs, and it made it for so much nicer. And so I actually only got sick a couple times from the other chemo they had to give me on the day that I would only do it for once for the whole week, and it's called cisplatin. And it's pretty nasty stuff. It's like rat poison, they were telling me. But I got what they call a chemical fever. I got that twice, and that was the only time I got sick. But I'll tell you what, folks, I'd go through that again than to go through that divorce that I went through that started me on the flutes, for sure, because I got a lot of love from all my community and friends. I have no family in Washington. I'm the only one that lives up there and stuff. All my peeps all live down in Cali and stuff. So, but I'm glad that I had these to play, because I would go back and play for those people after I was treated and I was done, and I would say, look at me. And I said, you're gonna get better, and everything's gonna be good, because you gotta have faith in yourself. You gotta believe, you know. And for me, I'm like, I'm not done yet. I wanna keep on going, and I certainly am. So thank you very much. I'm 14 years out. I'm 14 years out, and I just turned 66. 1957 was a good year. Thank you. about my connection with these instruments. I wanted to know, how do I connect with all this? As somebody who was growing up, and you know, Southern California is very diverse. I think diversity is a good thing. It's a cool thing. I have a son who's English and Irish. We like to mix it up. And his mother came to this country on the Mayflower. And so, and that's a whole nother show. My son's name is Maximiliano Peter Ali. And he's a beautiful young man. He's a gay man. He's a very beautiful gay man. I love him dearly. He was born this way. That's how I feel. And I didn't think otherwise about it. I said, I love you no matter what. Now, unfortunately, we don't communicate. And that's, like I said, that's another show. And he's in LA and he's doing really well. He works at some high-end restaurant. His mother is, if you can imagine, I got the cool tan. Well, his mom's got the fair skin and green eyes and blonde hair. So I haven't seen him since he was 4. And he's got to be, oh, I don't know. He's got to be maybe in his 30s by now and stuff. So anyways, that's another show to tell sometime. But I am proud of him, and I love him dearly. So, and that's the only child I have. I do have an adopted daughter, and that was from the second marriage. And, of course, I haven't seen her either, but she's in Seattle somewhere. But I have a dog, and he's a really wonderful dog. He came with us and stuff, and I have my best friend partner is shy over there. It's Jennifer. Hi, wave, Jennifer. So and stuff. So and I feel really good about it. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot. Okay. So this flute I'm going to play, it does not have any flute, no finger holes. Anybody ever seen one like this? No finger holes? Nope. Okay.
Check.
Make sure my camera is there. Now this is not side blown like a silver flute. It's not the same.
This is called a willow flute, salo flute, or salafloita. This is from Norway.
So is that just your overture?
Since you don't have to blow this like a silver flute, you can just blow into the mouthpiece. It's an overtone flute. And so the harder I blow, the higher the note. And my finger on the end of the tube changes the tonation. And so how did I get this? Well, I listen to music on YouTube. I don't use my phone as a music device. And so I was listening to somebody playing something very similar to this in the fjords, if you can imagine. Something like these played in the canyon. So I had to have one, and I looked and searched on the internet. Nobody makes these in the United States. So I found a music store in Sweden, Fredman's Music, and fortunately, they speak English. And so we communicated, and I said, I want a couple of these. And so I got one in the key of D and one in the key of G. And so the instructions on how to play it came in Norwegian. Now, I don't speak Norwegian, but I do know a couple of words. I know how to say thank you, tak, tak, tusen tak, mange tak. And yay or yai, depending on how you say it, if you are Norwegian, please forgive me. Yay or yai, askedai, I love you. That's an important word. We need to kind of remember that. That's a very important word to say to others. And so the story behind the instrument is that in the springtime, the guy would go to the willow tree and somehow get a branch, and he would hit the bark, pull the bark off. You have a hollow tube, and you would notch it in a certain place, and you would have this whistle that you could play songs with, but it would disintegrate after a few days. And so in 1961, somebody figured out how to make them so they could be played year-round. So this is PVC wrapped in birch bark. And these, you can play Celtic music with this as well. But there are some really good flute players in Sweden, and also Norway as well. The nearest person that gives lessons is in the Midwest. I'm not going to drive to the Midwest. So I taught myself. Well, the Norwegian name is Salafløyte, but the English name is willow flute, because it was made from a willow branch. So my connection to that is that it's played throughout the Nordic countries. The Sami people, who I have a DNA connection with, play that. So there's my connection to it. There's another thing that I think the Swedish do, coloring, or I can't pronounce the word, where the women are out singing with their voice, and they're calling in the cows. You can look at it. You can find it on YouTube. There's some great people that do that, and it's beautiful. It's music to the ears and stuff. So it's really an interesting culture. I've never been there myself, but I'm interested in the culture. I like the music. I listen, when I'm not doing this, I listen to folk music. I like Irish music, and I like music from the Nordic countries and stuff. So good thing you said that. Let me see. The other new flute, this is the second new flute I have. This one I got from a flute maker in Oregon, Singing Tree Flutes. And so I didn't get it too long ago. I haven't played it that much. It's in an Aeolian scale. Now, I didn't take time to read and love. What does that mean? It's just keyed differently. So I'll play you a short song on it. Oops. It has to be just right. This is a bass flute, and it's in C minor. I know that because it's written on it. Okay, this was gifted to me by a friend, but before it was his, it belonged to somebody else. It belonged to a world flautist who lives in the Midwest by the name of Peter Pippin. And so here's how the story goes. This guy who lives in Arlington named Paul Ninehouse, he loves native culture. He's not native, he's Dutch ancestry. And he makes flutes too, but anyways, he has a friend named Peter Pippin in the Midwest, in Minnesota or someplace over there. And so Paul likes to work on airplanes. That was his job. He has his own shop or had his own shop, and he had his own airplane. He had a Cessna 210, I believe a 210 or a 310, I'm not sure. That plane that was in Sky King, if I age myself, Sky King. Remember Sky King? Remember black and white TV? I certainly do. Anyways, so he gets in his airplane and he flies over to Minnesota's where Peter Pippin lives. And he goes over to Peter's house and he goes, "Hey, how's it going?" He goes, "Yeah, cool. Paul, good to see you, man." And Peter goes to Paul, "Hey, I got this flute for you. Check it out. I'm going to give this to you." And Paul goes, "Wow, dude, that's cool. Wow, nice. Thank you so much." And he gets in a Cessna 210 or 310 and flies back to Arlington Airport. And life goes on. And then one day I meet Paul because I love airplanes. And we had something in common, and he plays the flute and stuff, and we got to be good friends. And one day Paul goes, "Hey, Peter." I go, "What? What's going on, man?" "I got something for you." He goes, "Wow, what's that?" He goes, "Here, I'm going to gift you this flute." And I'm like, "Wow, Paul, wow, way cool. Dude, thank you so much." And so that's how I got this flute. It went from Peter to Paul to Peter. Was there a Mary in there? I don't know. So this is a flute made by, what the heck's his name? Butch Hall. How could I forget? Butch Hall from Texas. And it's made out of poplar. This is my ghost flute. So this has been a really wonderful journey for me as far as the flutes go. I would, you know, if anybody wants to, well, we are going to, hopefully I don't run out of time, but I did bring some extra flutes that I don't have enough for every single person in this audience. I have maybe 19 flutes, so hopefully we'll have time for that. And just so you know, these have all been sanitized. I know we haven't had a pandemic and all that. I'm fully vaccinated and I'm fully boosted. It doesn't mean I couldn't get sick, which I did 2 months ago, and my symptoms were nothing. Stuffy nose, that's it. And so, anyways, I've had these flutes for years, and I've taught many classes, tribal youth, adults, and like I said, every time they're used, they're sanitized with alcohol, and that kills whatever's in them. And just to make sure, I ask the flute makers, I go, "Is that what I should use?" Yeah, by all means, so. Anyhow, here's a flute that's a fairly new one of mine. Also, this is made by the guy who makes flutes for R. Carlos Nakai. And this was made in Montana, and this is more of a traditional looking flute, Lakota style flute. It has the metal in the front of the piece, the wood, the bird or whatever that directs the air. In the old days, that piece of metal would be a tobacco tin or a shell casing. So in the old days too, this is kind of how it happened. To make a flute, the guy would go to the cedar tree and he would give a tobacco offering. And then he would get the branch. And the branch would be as probably as long as his arm. And then he would split that branch in two. It would be cedar.
because cedar is known as the tree of life to most all native people. And you would take the sharp rock, a piece of flint, or if you traded with a European trader, you'd have a knife and you would dig out the soft heart of the cedar branch. It was your job to put the heart back into it. You would take the two halves, you put the two halves back together, you would use sinew, you would use pitch, or you would use the esophagus from a bison. And then you figure, well, where are the holes? How do you make the holes? You don't have any craftsman tools. Well, you use a measurement of the spaces between your fingers or your thumb, so many spaces, and you would take a hot stick and you would burn the holes in. And that's how you made the holes. And then it was key to the maker's voice. And then he would compose a song. And then, and by the way, the people in the plains, the men, was men only that played these, not the women. And so they were called love flutes or courting flutes. So the guy would compose a song, he would go to her dwelling, and he would stand outside her dwelling, and he would play her a song. And if she liked it, she would come out and stand next to him, and he would put his blanket around her, and that was their time together. They were always being watched by the elders. And I guess if she didn't like his song, he was out of luck, but anyhow. But these are wonderful for courting, I'll say that, for any occasion. I've played these not just at weddings, but at memorials as well, and for somebody in a hospice, which means a lot to do that, honored to do that, so. This flute is called Little Dog. Okay, so my second to the last flute I'm going to play. I'm running out of time. What time does the library close? Oh, okay. I thought we could kind of go till 8, but anyhow. I know, I'm surprised I'm not worn out from driving down here, but anyhow. Anyways, this flute here is another creation from Guillermo Martinez. This is a Tlingit-style carving. And does anybody recognize the bird? You're close. Raven, that is correct. What does Raven have in his beak? That's correct. It is from the children's story, How Raven Stole the Sun. And I got this because my friend Gene Tagaban, who is he's a Raven dancer from the Raven clan, and he was the reason I got to play for the Dalai Lama and others. He tells that story and stuff. So I'll play you a quick little song. From Raven.
It's in the key of D.
D. This is in the key of D. I have CDs. This was 3 years ago. It's their best-selling CD. It's Prayers on the Wind. It's me and Dean Evanson. Dean is almost 80. He plays the silver flute, and we played together. It's been a hit. It's also on Spotify and Pandora, if you like to do that sort of thing. And then River of Life, Renee Roma knows. I believe she's Comanche, She lives here in Oregon, not too far away. She's a poet, and I did some music with her poetry. She is descendant of a survivor of the Sand Creek Massacre. Okay, and so $15 for each of these. I have stickers for $3, and there's a poster of me I'll be happy to sign. That's free and all that. So I'm going to do one more song for you. Because I didn't realize it closed at 7. So people ask me, can you play a song that we might recognize? I can do that. I can play Ain't No Sunshine by Bill Wither, but I gotta hear it. So I'm going to play this other song. You've been a fabulous audience. Thank you very much for coming tonight. Like I said, I'm easily accessible via all the information on the cards. I'm happy to share my diversity with you as a son of immigrants and who has ancestors that were already here. I just have to say, I don't identify with the words that they're given to us. I don't consider myself Hispanic or some other the colonial words that I just don't identify with. I have indigenous ancestors. I'm a person of many people, and thank goodness for my ancestors, for the love of them, because I wouldn't be standing here today. So. Oh, what a joy it is to play through this instrument. This is how I speak, and this is how I sing. This is how I pray. This is how I cry. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for coming.